Thank you, Jazakallah Khair, for the very rapt, kind and rapt attention you all have shown during the course of the lecture. Now we come to the second part of our session, and we hope to have a similar, in fact, a better interest of yours, that is the question and answer session. To derive more benefit for all present here today, in the limited time available to us, we would like the following rules to be observed during the question and answer session. First, questions asked should be on the topic, is the Quran God's word only? Questions not pertaining to the topic will not be entertained. Kindly state your question briefly and to the point. This is a question and answer time and not a lecture or a debate time. Number three, only one question at a time may be asked. For your second question, you would have to go back at the row again and line up again and await your second chance for questioning. Questions on slips from the audience may be considered for answers from the speaker in the later part of the question and answer session only if time permits. You may pass on the question slips to the volunteers in the aisles or in the center, who will in turn pass on the slips onto the stage. Three mics have been provided for the questions from the audience, two for the gents next to the stage in front here, and one at the back in the ladies section. Please stand in a queue at one of the mics if you wish to put a question to the speaker, and speak directly into the mic only. That also when the mic is handed over to you by the mic handling assistants. We will allow only one question on each of the mics. First a lady, then a gent on my right hand side, then a lady at the back again, then a gent on my left hand side, then a lady, and so on. Are the mic handling assistants ready? Those who would like to ask questions on the mics, they may queue up on the two side mics and one at the back for their questions. We can start the session right away. The ladies ready at the mics, the gents at theirs. We start the questions. The speaker willing and ready at his. May we have the first question from the ladies, please? I would coordinate the session from the table. I think that would be better for me. The ladies can ask the first question.
I am Mrs. Sarla Ramchandran. I would like to ask, why do Muslims call God Allah?
The question posed by the sister is, why do Muslims call God as Allah? During my talk, I've given the definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the Quran, from Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, which says, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. Say He is Allah one and only. Allahu samad. Allah the absolute, the eternal. لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. He begets not, nor is begotten. وَلَمْ يَقُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ. And there is nothing unto Him like in this world. But the Quran also says in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 110, it says, قُلْ إِذُ اللَّهُ أَوْلِذُ الرَّحْمَانِ أَيَّمَا تَدْءُوا فَلَوْ الْأَسْمَى الْحَسْنَى. Say, call upon Him by Allah or by Rahman. By whichever name you call upon Him, to Him belongs the most beautiful names. The same message that to Allah belongs the most beautiful name is mentioned in Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 180, in Surah Hashar, chapter number 59, verse number 24, as well as in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 8. It says, to Allah belongs the most beautiful name. But the name should not conjure up a mental picture. It should be a beautiful name. Why do Muslims prefer calling God Almighty as Allah than the English word God? Because the Arabic word Allah is a pure word. The English word God, it can be played around with. If you add an S to God, it becomes gods, plural of God. You can't add an S to Allah. There is nothing like plural Allah. Allah is one. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. Say is Allah one and only. If you add a D-E-S-S to God, it becomes goddess, a female god. There's nothing like female Allah or male Allah. Allah has got no gender. If you have a God with a capital G, it becomes true God. If you have a God with a small G, it becomes fake God. In Islam, we have only one true Allah. We don't have any fake Allahs, only true Allah. If you add father to God, it becomes Godfather. He's my Godfather. He's my guardian. You can't add a Abba to Allah or a father to Allah. There's nothing like Allah Abba or Allah Father in Islam. If you add a mother to God, it becomes Godmother. You can't add a mother to Allah or a Ammi to Allah. There's nothing like Allah Ammi in Islam. If you put a tin before God, it becomes tin God, fake God. In Islam, there's nothing like tin Allah. Allah is pure, He is unique. You can call Him by any name, but it should be a beautiful name. I hope that answers the question.
May all the speakers kindly note, questioners kindly note, that they should state their name and occupation before they put forward their question, so you get an exact and more appropriate answer. Thank you. The next question from the gents on the right side.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Tazim Dabir. My question is, Arun Shauri says that in the Quran in chapter 4, verses 11 and 12, if you add up the different parts of inheritance given to the highs, the sum total is more than one. Therefore, Arun Shauri claims that the author of the Quran does not know maths. Please clarify.
The brother posed the question that according to Arun Shauri, in the Quran, in chapter number 4, verse number 11 and 12, he says, if you add up the sum total of all the different parts of the hairs, the total comes to more than one. Therefore, he claims that the author of the Quran does not know maths, as I mentioned to you in my talk. There are hundreds of people who have taken false in the Quran, but if you analyze, all of them are not true. None of them are true, not a single one is true. Regarding inheritance, Quran speaks about inheritance in several places. In Surah Baqarah chapter number 2, verse number 180, in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2, verse number 240, in Surah Nisa chapter number 4, verse number 9, it's mentioned in Surah Nisa chapter number 4, verse number 99, it's mentioned in Surah Maidah chapter number 5, verse number 105, in several places. But regarding the detailed explanation of the shares, it's mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Nisa chapter number 4, verse number 11 and 12, and in Surah Nisa chapter number 4, verse number 176. Regarding the translation of the verse quoted by Arun Shauri, that is Surah Nisa chapter number 4, verse number 11 and 12, it says that regarding the shares of inheritance for your children, the male gets a part double than that of a female. If only daughters, two or more, they share in a two-third. If only daughter one, she gets half. And the verse continues. As regarding the parents, they each get one-sixth share if they have children. If no children, then mother gets one-third. after paying off the legacies and debts. Verse number 12 says that in what your wives leave for you, you get half if no children, and one fourth if there are children, after paying off the debts and legacies. In what you leave for your wife, they share one fourth if no children, and one eighth if there are children. It's a bit confusing. Don't get confused. You can go home and refer it. In short, in verse number 11 of Surah Nisa chapter 4, the first share that is mentioned is of the children, then of the parents, and later on in verse number 12 it gives the share of the spouses. Now, regarding inheritance, Islam speaks in a great detail. Quran only gives the basic outline. The great details, you have to refer to the hadith. And a man can spend his full life only doing research on inheritance. And Arun Shuri, he expects to know about this just by quoting two verses. It is somewhat similar that a person wants to solve an arithmetical equation and does not know the basic rule of arithmetic, that is BOD mass. According to the rule of BOD mass, BODMAS, irrespective whichever arithmetical sign comes, whether they come first or last, first you have to solve brackets of BO, then D, that is division, then M, that is multiplication, then A, that is addition, and then S, that is subtraction. If you don't know the rule of BOD mass, and if first you do subtraction, then you do multiplication, then do addition, then do brackets off, you will surely get the answer wrong. In the same way, Arun Shuri himself does not know maths, because for the division of inheritance, according to the Islamic law, first share goes to the spouses and the parents. After that, whatever is remaining is shared between the children. If you follow this rule, the sum total can never come more than one. I hope that answers the question.
Batnavar Bandhu, main acha puch raha hu, bata raha hu.
May we have the next question from the lady's side, then we will allow you, sir. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Fauzia Sayyad. I am working in BMC as inspector. I was a Christian and embraced Islam in 1980. How can I convince my parents, who are yet Christian, that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, did not copy the Quran from the Bible?
The sister posed the question that she has reverted to Islam. She has accepted Islam. First, she was a Christian. I would like to congratulate her. Thrice, not once. To the atheist, I congratulate once. To her, I congratulate thrice. Because after saying La ilaha, she said Illallah, and then Muhammadur Rasulullah. That is, there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad, may peace be upon him, is the messenger of Allah. I would like to congratulate you. The question posed is that how can she prove, how can she convince her relatives that Quran has not been copied or Quran has not been plagiarized from the Bible? As I told you, that one historical fact that the Prophet was illiterate is sufficient to prove this. But Quran also says in Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 157, that they follow the Prophet, they follow the messenger, the unlettered Prophet, which is mentioned in the scriptures, the law and the gospel. And today, if you read the Bible, it is mentioned in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 29, verse number 12, the book is given to a prophet who's not learned. Quran says, it's mentioned in the scripture, and if you open the Bible, it is there. In Isaiah, chapter number 29, verse number 12. those Orientalists who claim that the Prophet copied from the Bible, na'uz billah, they fail to realize that there was no Arabic version of the Bible when the Prophet was present. The first, the earliest Old Testament in Arabic that we have was by R. Sadius Gaon in the year 900 CE, that is common error, more than 200 years after the death of the Prophet. And the earliest New Testament in Arabic that we have was published by Erpinius in 1616, about 1,000 years after the death of the Prophet, may peace be upon him. I do agree that there are some similarities between the Bible and the Quran. That does not indicate that the latter has been copied from the former. It can also mean that they both have a common third source. All the revelations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have the common message of monotheism. They have the common message. All the previous revelations, since they were time bound, as I mentioned, they have not been maintained in the original form and have been interpolated. And there are several concoctions which have been done by human beings. But there are bound to be a few points which are common. Just because of these similarities, it would be wrong to say that Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, copied from the Bible. Then it would also mean that Jesus, may peace be upon him, na'uz billah, copied the New Testament from the Old Testament. Because there are many things common in the Old and the New Testament. Both of them had a common source. And suppose someone copies in an examination. Suppose I copy in an examination. I will not write in the answer paper, I have copied from my neighbor. I will not write, I have copied from Mr. XYZ. Muhammad, may peace be upon him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly indicate that Jesus, may peace be upon him, Moses, may peace be upon him, all the other prophets were prophets of God Almighty. It gives them due credit and due respects. If he would have copied, he would not have mentioned that Jesus and Moses, may peace be upon him, were prophets of God. This proves he did not copy. Only based on historical facts, it is difficult for a person to say which of the two is correct, Bible or the Quran. But let us put it to test using our scientific knowledge. On the face of it, if you glance, many stories, many points mentioned in the Quran and the Bible are exactly the same. But if you analyze, there is a difference of chalk and cheese. Bible, for example, mentioned in the first book, in the book of Genesis, chapter number 1, the creation of the universe, the heaven and the earth, it was created in 6 days. And the day is described as a 24-hour period. Quran 2 speaks at several places. In Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 54. In Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, verse number 3. Several places that the heavens and the earth were created in 6 ayams. The Arabic word ayam is the plural of yom, which means day. Yom means day. It also means a very, very long period or an epoch. So here when the Quran says, the heaven and the earth were created in 6 epochs, very, very long period, the scientists have got no objection to description of the Quran. But to say that the world was created in 624 days is unscientific. The Bible says in Genesis, chapter number 1, verse number 3 and 5, that the day and the night were created on the first day. And science tells us that the light circulating in the universe is due to a reaction of the stars. And the Bible says that the sun, Genesis chapter number 1, verse number 14 to 19 says, that the sun was created on the fourth day. how is it possible that the result, that is the light, was created 3 days before the sun? It's illogical. It's unscientific. And the earth, which is required for the presence of day and night, was created on the third day. Quran too speaks about the creation of the light and the sun, but it does not give this impossible, unscientific sequence. Do you think Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, he copied from the Bible and he made corrections in the sequence? No one knew 1400 years ago. Bible says in Genesis chapter number 1, verse number 9 to 13, that the earth was created on the third day. And verse number 14 to 19 says, the sun and the moon was created on the fourth day. Today science tells us that the earth and the moon are parts of the original star, the sun. It's impossible that the earth was created before the sun. It's unscientific. Bible says that the vegetable kingdom, in Genesis chapter number 1, verses 11 to 13, the vegetable kingdom, along with the seed-bearing plants, herbs, trees, etc., was created on the third day. And the sun, verses 14 to 19 says, was created on the fourth day. How can the vegetation come into existence without the sun? Bible says in Genesis chapter number 1, verse number 16, that God Almighty created two great lights, the sun, the greater light, to rule the day, and the moon, the lesser light, to rule the night. Bible says that sun and the moon have its own light. And as I mentioned earlier, Quran clarifies in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 61, that the light of the moon is its reflected light. How is it possible that our beloved Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, copied and corrected all the scientific facts? It's not possible. If you analyze the several stories that are mentioned in the Quran and the Bible, if you analyze closely, there's a difference of chalk and cheese. Bible mentions about the story of Adam, may peace be upon him, that the first man to be created on the earth was Adam. And the Bible gives the date approximately 5,800 years ago. Science today, according to the archaeological evidence and the anthropological evidence, says that the first human being was present tens of thousands of years ago. Quran too speaks about Adam, may peace be upon him, as the first man, but does not give this unscientific date. Bible speaks about the story of Noah alayhi salam, Noah, may peace be upon him, that there was a flood. There was a universal flood in Genesis chapter number 6, 7, 8. There was a universal flood in which all living creatures on the earth were submerged and were killed in this flood, except those people that were there in the Ark of Noah, may peace be upon him. The date according to the Bible is approximately in the 21st to 22nd century. Today, archaeological evidence shows us that the 11th dynasty of Egypt and the 3rd dynasty of Babylonia existed without an interruption in the continuation in the 21st century BC. Quran too speaks about Noah, may peace be upon him, and the flood, but does not give a date. And the flood which the Quran speaks about is localized flood. It does not speak about a universal cataclysm. It says that the flood was localized to the people of Noah only, may peace be upon him, which scientists today have got no objection. So you yourself can decipher whether the Quran has been copied or not from the Bible.
Thank you. I would request our speakers who are questioners, who are coming on the mics, and those who are sending me slips up, kindly restrain yourself to the topic of the day, which is the Quran God's word, so that we don't have to tell you that this is out of topic. We have received a question on Taslima Nasreen and on justice, women's rights. I would request if the topic is covered, like women's rights, we have already got cassettes, we would not entertain these topics here. Though Zakir would be able to answer, we would not entertain it here. If you want to know about women's rights, you could take the whole cassette, it covers up the whole issue. Those who want to know about Taslima Nasreen, there is a press debate held by the Bombay Union of Journalists in which Dr. Zakir has already spoken on Tasreema Nasreen in total detail issue, where they cross-examined him in detail. And any topic which is out, it may be very important to you. It may be important for the other audience also here, but if it's not related to the topic of the day, it would not be entertained. Kindly help us by restraining yourself on this issue. Thank you. May I have your name and occupation before you put forward a question? Thank you.
Mahatmar Bandho, my name is Ashok Kishrani. I am Sampadak of Arya Marg Patrika. I am asking questions before I ask you so Hafiz sahab ko jinhon itna ilmiyat se diya hai hame lecture usko salam karta hu aur ek galat fehmi dur karke sawal puchta hu wo ye hai inhone Rajni sahab ke kaha ki hindu unko bhagwan mante hain ye sirf unke shishya hain thode bahut wo mante hain baki aur hindu samaj mein arya samaj mein koi bhi nahi manta usko bhagwan sirf bol ke bhagwan phir usko is ved mein saaf likha hai ईश्वर सचनान स्वरूप निराकार सर्वशक्तिमान अजन्मा अमर निर्भय जितने भी कुरान अपने बातें बताए खुदा की वो बिल्कुल ईश्वर की बात हम मानते हैं इसलिए उसको खुदा नहीं मानते. सवाल मेरा ये है कुरान शरीफ की तालीम के बमूजब क्या आप इंसानी हक तस्लीम करते हैं कि इंसान खुदा के मुतालिक दुनिया के और हादी और पैगम भी आए उन्होंने कई बातें सुनाई वो पढ़ने को आजादी आप तस्लीम करते हैं आप मदरसे में वेद शास्त्र जो आप बोलते हैं कि पहले भी आ चुके हैं पैगाम वो पढ़ाते हैं वो चाहते हैं कि वो भी सब पढ़े कि कंपरेटिव स्टडी हो सिर्फ कुरान शरीफ ना हो और भी हो ये आप तस्लीम करते हैं या नहीं.
आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट के द क्वेश्चनर्स हु कम अप हियर वी वुड रिक्वेस्ट देम टू पुट द क्वेश्चन फॉरवर्ड इन इंग्लिश बिकॉज द लेक्चर इज इन इंग्लिश एंड द ऑडियंस हियर मोस्ट ऑफ देम दे हैव कम फॉर अ लेक्चर इन इंग्लिश दो द स्पीकर may understand the question for a wider appreciation of the people collected here. We would request you to kindly put forward your question in English. We would make this as the first exception. He looks quite elderly, a very knowledgeable person in that context. As a coordinator, I make an exception for the first time.
The brother, before posing the question, he said that all the Hindus do not believe in Bhagwan Dajnish. Brother, I never said in my talk that all the Hindus believe in Dajnish. Here, it's been video recorded. You can have the cassette. I said, some people believe in Bhagwan Dajnish. So there was a misunderstanding between you and me. I never said that all the Hindus believe. I know what the Hindus believe, even I have studied the scriptures. And the brother posed the question, and he posed a very good question, that do I agree that since the Quran says he has sent several messengers and several revelations, do I believe in the Vedas? Do I believe in the Ved Shastra and do I believe in the other messengers or not? That's the main question. I do agree with him. Quran says in several places. Quran says in Surah Fatir, chapter number 35, verse number 24, it says, وَإِمْ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَافِيَا نَزِيرٍ, that there is not a nation to whom we have not sent a warner or a guide. The Quran says in Surah Raad, chapter number 13, verse number 7, وَلِقُلِّ قَوْمٍ هَادٍ, and to every nation have we sent a warner. Regarding your question, that do you believe that the way is Shastra and do you believe that the other prophets are prophets of God? By name, the Quran mentions 25 prophets by name. Adam, Abraham, Moses, Ismail, Jesus, Muhammad, may peace be upon them all. But according to the tradition, there are more than 1,24,000 prophets sent on the face of the earth. By name, we know in 25. Others, maybe, may not be, we can't say for sure. Regarding a question, that do you consider the Veds to be the word of God? Let's see, are there any common points between the Veds and the Quran? Yes, there are. Since the topic is of God, the Quran too speaks about, the Ved also speaks about God. If you read the Vedas, it's mentioned in the Yajurveda, chapter number 3, verse number 32. Na tasya pratima asti, of that God, you cannot make any image. The Yajurveda says, in chapter number 32, verse number 3, God is formless and bodiless. The same Yajurveda, chapter number 40, verse number 8 says, God has got no image, has got no body. Same Yajurveda. chapter number 40, verse number 9 says that all those who worship the uncreated things, they are in darkness. And it continues. Andhatma pavishanti ya sambhuti mupaste. That you are entering more into darkness if you worship the created things. If you worship uncreated things, you are in darkness, like air, water, uncreated. If you worship the created things of woods and stones, you are more in darkness. Who says that? The Yajurveda, chapter number 40, verse number 9. It is said in the Hindu scriptures, Ekam Braham Dustya Naste, Niya Naste Naste Kinchan, of that God. Bhagwan Eki hai, Dusra Nahi hai, Zara Bhi Nahi hai. There is only one God, not a second one, not in the least bit. We mentioned the Rig Veda, volume number 8, chapter number 1, verse number 1, Ma Chidanyadi Sansad, all praises are due to him alone. It's mentioned in the Rig Veda, volume number 6, chapter number 45, verse number 16, Ya Ekit Mushtihi, there is only one God, worship him. We believe in it. We have got no objection in accepting these portions of Vedas. They may be the word of God. Quran is the criteria to judge what is right, what is wrong, because it is the last and final revelation. We Muslims have got no objection in accepting all these things as the word of God. But there may be other things, as I said, there may be interpolation, which I know of many, which I don't want to discuss here. It may be, there may be interpolation, there may be human work, which we cannot accept as the word of God. As there are unscientific facts in the Bible, the same also there in the Vedas. I don't discuss that. So we have got no objection that originally Vedas may have been the word of God. Injil, the Quran says, Injil is the Wahi given to Isa alayhi salam. It is a revelation given to Jesus, may peace be upon him. So we can say for sure that Injil was the word of God. But the present Bible is an interpolation. In the same way, I may say that Veda may have been the word of God. And regarding the messengers, yes, there are several messengers. Several. Regarding Ram, Krishna, other messengers. What we say, maybe, we can say, but we can't say for sure. There are some Muslims who say that the Ram alayhi salam, that's wrong. See, they're scratching their back. I do not have to scratch the back of the Hindu, so he scratches my back. What I'm saying, they may be, but even if they are, even if Ram is the messenger of God Almighty, even if Veda is a scripture of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as I mentioned, they were time bound. They were only meant for those people at that time. And the message is not eternity. Quran is the last and final message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if Injil, even if Bible, even if Veda were the word of God, they were for that time, not for today. Quran is the last and final word of God, and the last and final messenger is Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him. We have to follow the Quran and the Prophet. Hope that answers the question.
The next question from the lady side.
My name is Mehnaz Sayyid, and I am a student. My question is, who created Allah?
The question posed by the sister is, who created Allah? It is a question normally posed by the atheists, by the rationalists. That reminds me of an occasion that once my friend, he's a very close friend of mine, he had gone to a discussion with the rationalist group of Bombay, the atheist group. And he tried to convince them about the existence of God Almighty. And he started off saying that this is a cloth. Who created it? Where did it come from? They said a weaver created it. Fine. It has a creator, yes. This is a book. Where did it come from? Where did the book come from? Where did the pen come from? Like that, he tried and proved to them that everything has a creator. The car, it was created in a factory. Who created the factory? Maybe the engineer. Who created the engineer? He went on trying and proving everything as a creator. And then he asked the question, who created the sun? Who created the moon? And while asking these questions, he said, do you agree everything has a creator? So the rationalist group, they paused and they said, we will agree that everything has a creator only on the condition that you do not change your statement, that you do not go back on your statement. We will agree everything has a creator, but you should not go back on your statement that everything has a creator. My friend was very pleased. He was happy. I have been successful. I have been successful in convincing this atheist. And he poses the next question. Who created the sun? Who created the moon? Everything has a creator. You have to name who was the final creator. I have come from my mother. My mother has come from her mother. Finally, who is the first creator? And he helps them with the answer. The first creator who created everything is God Almighty. And thinking that he had won the discussion, the atheist posed the question, we agree in God Almighty. On the condition, you give us the answer, who created God? And my friend got the shock of his life. He could not answer. He was dumbstruck. He could not sleep the whole night. Next day, he came to me and he told me and he narrated the whole incident to me. And I realized he was using the methodology used by some scholars to prove the existence of God. These scholars, they have missed out a very important rule of logic known as self-analysis. Self-analysis. If you analyze in my talk, never in my talk did I ever say that everything has a creator. Never did I say that. If I would have said that, I would have been trapped. In fact, I was the person who asked the atheist, and the atheist gave the reply that the first person who will know the mechanism is the creator, the manufacturer. I didn't say that, he said it. If suppose someone poses the same question to me, Brother Zakir, who will be the person to tell the mechanism of an unknown object? I will tell him that everything which has a beginning, everything which is created, the first person who will be able to tell the mechanism of such things is the creator. I am using my logic. I don't want to get trapped again. If I say this answer, that the first person will be the first person who will be able to tell the mechanism of anything which is created, which has a beginning, is the creator, you can use that same argument and still prove that Quran is the word of God. The final answer will be, because science tells us, the sun has a beginning, the moon has a beginning, our universe has a beginning. Who will know the mechanism? The creator, God Almighty. You ask me the question, who created Allah? It is somewhat similar to a question posed to me by my friend. He said that my brother Tom, he was admitted to the hospital and he conceived and gave birth to a child. Can you tell me, was the child a girl or a boy? I know as a doctor that a male cannot conceive and give birth to a child. The quality of a male is it cannot conceive and give birth to a child. It's an absurd question. Same way, the definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Allah is uncreated. He does not have a beginning. So if you ask me the question, who created Allah? It is as absurd as my friend asking me that my brother Tom gave birth to a child. Is it a male or a female? Hope that answers the question.
My name is Muhammad Ashraf. My question is, I'm a student. My question is, many Orientalists claim or rather allege that the Prophet, peace be upon him, wrote the Quran for the moral reformation of the Arabs and attributed it to God for better acceptability.
The brother posed the question, and I do agree with him, that some of the Orientalists have said that the beloved Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, he told a lie, na'uzubillah, by saying the Quran is the word of God, so that he could reform the Arabs. I do agree that the message of the Quran and the intention of Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, was not only to reform Arabia. The intention of the Quran and our beloved Prophet was to reform the whole world, not only Arabia. If you say, let's analyze this claim, if his main reason was only to reform Arabia, then why should a person use immoral means to make a moral society? Imagine, you want to make a moral society, but you yourself start by telling a lie. This can only be done by people who are fake, who do it for money. Openly they may say, we want to reform the world, but inwardly they want money. And I've already disproved that the Prophet did not do it for money. So if the final end result is truth, even the means should be truthful. It's mentioned in the Quran, in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 93, that who can be more wicked than a person who invents a lie against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and says that I have received an inspiration when no inspiration has come to him, or says that I can invent a revelation the same as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the Prophet had actually lied, he would have never mentioned in his own book that the person who lies is a wicked person. In some point of his life, maybe his lie would be exposed, then he would be calling himself as a wicked person. And the verse continues to give a humiliating punishment. Again it's mentioned Surah Al-Haqqah, chapter number 69, verse number 44 and 47, that if the messenger was to invent a lie in our name, in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we would seize him by his hand, we would seize him by his right hand and cut off the artery of his heart, and you will not be able to save him from our wrath. Even the messenger is not excused. If any messenger was to invent a lie, let it be even Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, na'uz billah, he will never do it. Even if any messenger invents a lie, the Quran says, we will cut off the artery of his heart. There were chances that if the Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, would have lied, surely he would have been exposed in some point of life. And he would be calling, he would be telling other people to put him to death. A similar punishment is mentioned in Surah Al-Shuara, chapter number 42, verse number 24, as well as in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 105. And there are several instances in which the Prophet himself was corrected in the Quran. If the Prophet wrote the Quran for moral reformation, na'uz billah, surely he would not have mentioned those things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not like the Prophet doing. For example, one such verse, one such surah is Surah Abasa, chapter number 80. It says that, O Prophet, when the blind man came interrupting, he frowned and turned away. What dost thou know, lest he may increase in spiritual guidance or receive admonition? This surah was revealed when a blind man by the name of Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum interrupted the Prophet when he was having a discussion with the pagan Arabs, the non-Muslims. And the Prophet did not appreciate interruption, because when he's speaking with a non-Muslim chief, why should a blind Muslim come and interrupt? If it would have been anyone else besides the Prophet, let it be a saint or a sinner, no one would have objected. But because the Prophet, whose character was so noble, it was so high, whose heart always wept for the poor and the needy, for him, a revelation came down. And whenever the Prophet met this person, he always thanked him that because of you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had remembered me. Several such reproofs have been given in the Quran. For example, Surah Tahrim, chapter number 66, verse number 1. In Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 126. In Surah Anfal, chapter number 8, verse number 67. In Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 84. In several places, If the Prophet would have written the Quran for moral reformation, he would not have incorporated this in the Quran. Hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum, brother. I'm a medical student. Brother, in your lecture you spoke about several scientific facts. Are there any facts relating to mathematics in the Quran? Please clarify.
The sister posed the question that I have mentioned several scientific facts. Are there any mathematical facts mentioned in the Quran, or does this Quran speak anything about mathematics? Yes, the Quran speaks about several things about mathematics. One such law of mathematics, which the whole mathematics is actually based on, the law of Aristotle, the excluded middle. It says that every proposition, every statement can either be true or false. And for years everyone followed this law. 100 years ago, there was a person who posed the question that if every statement, every proposition can either be true or false, even this is a statement, even this can be false, what if this is false? The whole mathematics was going to collapse. And all the mathematicians got together and they took out a new consensus, new theory, saying that whenever anyone utilizes a word, it can either be used. When you use a word, you talk about its meaning, not the word. But when you mention the word, you talk about the word, not the meaning. Let me give you an example. That if I say that Akbar is small. Meaning-wise, it's right. He's a small boy. Akbar is small, no problem. But a person who knows Arabic, he may take objection. Akbar is not small. Akbar means great. See, here I was mentioning the word. I was not using the word. Let me give you another example. That suppose, if I say, 3 always comes before 4. No one will have any objection. 3 always comes before 4. But a skeptic, he will tell me, no, 3 comes after 4 in a dictionary, because T comes after F. He's saying objection that my statement, 3 comes before 4 is wrong. In the dictionary, 3 comes after 4, because T comes after F. Now when I was saying 3 comes before 4, I was talking about the meaning. I was not talking about the mentioning. The skeptic who's taking an objection is talking about the mentioning, not the meaning. So when a word is utilized, it can be utilized in two ways, either meaning or mentioning. During my talk, I quote a verse of the Quran, of Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 82, which says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرَانَ وَلَوْ قَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. That do not they consider the Quran with care? Had it been from anyone besides Allah, there would have been many contradictions. Meaning-wise, it's absolutely clear. No one has been able to take out a single contradiction, so Quran is the word of God. But there's a skeptic who says that I can take out a contradiction. He says, where? So he says, open chapter number 4, verse number 82. The word contradiction is there. The word ikhtilaf is there in the Quran. Quran is proved wrong. The word ikhtilaf is there in the Quran. Is the author tripping itself? I said, wait. Read the full verse. It says, do not they consider the Quran with care? Had it been from anyone besides Allah, there would have been many contradictions. And the ikhtilafun kasira, the word ikhtilaf, the word contradiction in the full Quran occurs only once. So yet, even mentioning wise, the Quran does not trip itself. It is safe. The word ikhtilaf is only mentioned once. And the Quran says, ikhtilafun kasira, many contradictions. We are safe. Another skeptic will come forward and say, okay, I agree, ikhtilaf is only once. But Quran says, do not they consider the Quran with care? Had it been from anyone besides Allah, there would have been many contradictions. The word many contradictions is there. The word ikhtilafun kathira is there. So Quran is not from God. I know it's a bit difficult to understand, but I will give you a simpler example later on. It's a bit difficult to understand. The vice versa is not always true. When the Quran says that if the Quran would not, do not consider the Quran with care, had it been from anyone besides Allah, there would have been contradiction. The Quran does not say that if there are many contradiction, the Quran would have not been from Allah. If the Quran would have mentioned that if there were many contradiction, this book is not from Allah, then the Quran would have been proved wrong. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses words. Because the vice versa need not always be true. Let me give you an example. That suppose, if I say that all the people living in Bombay, all the Bombayites, they are Indians. It's a true statement. But the vice versa need not be true. All Indians don't stay in Bombay. Some may stay, some may not. So the rule says, the vice versa is not always true. So when Quran says, do not they consider the Quran with care, had it been from anyone besides Allah, there would have been many contradictions. So if there are contradictions, it can be from Allah, it cannot be from Allah also. So the Quran does not trip itself. Let me give you a simple example. It mentions Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 1, that the true believers are humble in prayers. Now someone will tell me, I know a Muslim who prays 5 times a day, but he robs, he cheats. There are black sheep in every community. See, the Quran is wrong. Quran says, true believers are humble in prayer. So I say, wait, listen to the words of the Quran. Quran says, true believers are humble in prayer. Quran does not say, all those who are humble in prayer are true believers. If the Quran would have said, all those who are humble in prayer are true believers, Quran would have been proved wrong. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the best mathematician. He knows there are skeptics who are going to take out fault in the Quran. He chooses the words. I'd like to give one more example. That the Quran mentions Surah Imran chapter number 3 verse number 59 that the similitude of Jesus in front of Allah is the same as Adam, may peace be upon them. He was created from dust and said, be, and it was. Meaning wise, we have no objection. Jesus Christ, may peace be upon him, Adam, may peace be upon him, both were created from dust. Meaning wise, it is absolutely clear. But if you count in the Quran, the word Isa alayhi salam, Isa may peace be upon him, Jesus may peace be upon him, is mentioned 25 times in the full Quran. And if you count, Adam may peace be upon him, even he is mentioned 25 times. So, besides the meaning being same, even the mentioning is same. There are several such examples. In Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 176, it says that as to those who reject our signs, they are like dogs. The Arabic statement, as to those who reject our signs, is mentioned in the Quran 5 times. The Arabic word for dog is kalb. Even that is mentioned 5 times. Besides the meaning being same, even the mentioning is same. Surah Fatir chapter number 35, verse number 20 says that the darkness is not like light. Arabic word for darkness is zulumat. It is mentioned 23 times in the Quran. The word for light, Arabic word, is noor. It is mentioned 24 times in the Quran. So even besides the meaning being correct, even the mentioning matches that darkness is not like night. 23 is not like 24. So wherever Quran says this is like that, besides the meaning being same, even the mentioning is same. If the Quran says this is not like that, besides the meaning matching, even the mentioning will not match. And besides this, the Quran is coded so well, it's impossible to make the Quran, even by a computer. The example I gave you of Surah Imran chapter number 3 verse number 59, he says, the similitude of Jesus, may peace be upon him, in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is like Adam, may peace be upon him. He was created from dust, and being it was. Besides both being mentioned 25 times, if you start counting from Surah Fatiha chapter number 1, verse number 1, till Surah Imran, Allah is not testing you with food. But he tested some people with food, some people with wealth, some people with children, some people with spouses, different tests. So whenever you give an examination, you can't say that the examiner should give the same test to everyone. But irrespective, whatever the test is, the judgment should be just. Quran says, Malik Yawm al-Din, he is the master of the day of judgment. depending upon which test they give you, he judges that way. Suppose you are running a race and a person is lame. You know you have a handicap. So you give him in 100 meters dash, you give him a 50 meters lead. And a person who has both the legs, he starts from first. So that both have equal opportunity. So depending upon the test Allah has given you, he will judge you on the basis of that. Hope that answers the question.